Welcome, good cheer people out there. It's the Holy Hour podcast. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Gavin.
Donald.
And Donald's here again. I'm not even going to try to introduce you. There's no way to keep this bad boy on tracks tonight, my good people.
Pacing in my crate. He's pacing around.
He's ready to go.
I have tippy-tappy paws right now.
Hey, we got some high energy ready to deliver this beat-filled episode for you guys. We got some... This is
bad
a weird
boys tippy tapping at the back door like let me out.
Oh boy. We got a crazy kind of mashup episode for ourselves in a sense that we're trying to ride this wave of somehow syncing up our album reviews and what's current at the right time. So, because our next album we wanted to talk about was going to be mixed up.
Are we trying to be relevant?
And now it's almost relevant. Just a few weeks ago, Record Store Day, you've heard all about it, up and down. Reissue of Mixed Up, along with the bonus new album, Torn Down. So we're going to try our best to dive into both. The way we get rambling, this could end up being a six-hour episode. But this is a lot of remixes, and we're going to kind of keep them as a pair. So we're going to try to start out with Mixed Up, hopefully do it justice.
It's a lot of remixes.
Yeah, there's
a very simple way to
put it. A lot of remixes.
There's just two.
A lot of rehashed shit that we've borrowed here. Maybe this is the good question to just dive right in on the top. Where do you stand, Donald, in general on remixes? Not just Cure, life in general. Like, what the whole idea of the concept of a remix song, and even the Cure kind of varies on what they're going for, I think, definition-wise here. But what is the goal, right, and how do you feel about it?
I feel like I don't mind remixes. I like it when they go hard. I don't want to hear like a very close version of the song that's not the same.
Okay, so you like it when they change it up drastically?
Yes.
Okay.
There's a few. I can't think of that many remixes. There's a couple.
Cure, you mean? Or
Outside of the Cure, like there's like a probably like.
Yeah, I mean the easy comparison is like New Order, you know.
Yeah, like I like it when they go hard, like in a complete different direction. Like there's like a Mogwai, Fuck Buttons.
Mm-hmm.
It's a band, Fuck Buttons.
Yeah.
Like Fuck Buttons remixed one of their songs, and they did like a split single, and it's dope. It's so left field. Like it's so different, and that's what I like.
Because
like,
you rarely
different, man. Don't rehash shit,
right? Because you rarely get a straight up something that just feels like a different mix. I kind of even like maybe late 90s, it seemed there was a very short-lived pattern of like, I'm thinking of like that Flaming Lips album where you would get like even a bonus track that wasn't a hidden track, but sometimes they would just put two mixes of the same song. Yeah. You know, like Soft Bulletin had that, like Summer Teeth Wilco had that, and it was just kind of weird. I didn't like that at all, but it was kind of cool because you could hear like just the band was probably so torn on which version they liked more, you know? They're like, fuck it, let's put them both on there. And but yeah, it's a weird thing. So you're down from being drastic. What about dancey versus just remix? Because that's where it kind of seems to get tangled up too. Because sometimes it is just like a different mix, and then sometimes it's an extended mix where it's not necessarily more dancey, but you're just kind of emphasizing and making it longer.
Yes.
And then there's straight up dance versions and shit.
There's layers.
Yeah.
It makes me think of early reggae,
mm-hmm.
or reggae, but I'm gonna say reggae
or reggae. All three of those.
Early reggae, there'd be like a single would just be like the song, and then the B side would be the dub version.
Yeah,
you know, and that's like remix shit to me. Like, I love that. Where it's just like, I love the tradition of it, and it kind of got bastardized into not bastardized. It's still kind of cool because there's always like the club
versions, and
they have their moments. You know, that's just kind of dope.
That even almost makes more sense
to
me.
It's just fun. Like, I don't have many bad things to say about like the club mixes, huh. You know, like they're kind of stupid.
Yeah,
like, I'm gonna skip some shit, like because it's like I get it, you know. It's like, and I'm not in a club right now, like, but I appreciate them. But like,
it's weird because I feel like it's like a cool thing to do. For dancing, you know, for the clubs, you need because you.
When we do many dancings.
Yeah, I did not participate in this. That's why it probably seems so foreign and weird to me still. But I mean,
I'm doing the dancing now.
I don't know. I still feel probably more inclined being a non-club dancer to still just dance to the real version of a cool song than the official dance version. But that being said, I've been in plenty of like, you know, venues if it is whatever dance night or something and they throw dancey version of
like a 15-minute version of the forest.
Yeah, something out of forest. And it usually is just because it's longer, you know, and they don't have to, like, you know, change it up. You know, if you're doing a 3-minute pop song on a dance floor, that would be kind of weird, I guess, you know, because then it just is over.
Yeah.
But, so that makes sense. and then the weird mixes as B-sides is always cool. Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of always a little like, ugh, I'd rather have a rare song or something. But if they don't have it, you know, sure, why not throw some.
And I'd rather have more songs than less songs on, like, a maxi EP or maxi single, you know, where they toss in like a couple extra like a bonus long remix.
And even
songs, you know?
Yeah, and even better to a certain degree.
More bang for the buck.
Yeah, and I guess because I feel like a lot of the criteria for me still kind of falls of a remix and like what makes a cool remix or whatever still kind of falls almost in the category of a cover where it's like. Like you're saying, it's cool if you drastically change it, but don't butcher the song, you know, like a cover. But at the same time, you want to keep what's cool about the song. So if you change, like, what's cool about it, then you're kind of defeating the purpose.
Go hard or go home.
Yeah, but then at the same time, if you go too hard, that's kind of stupid, too, because it's like, oh, wow, you took out the three coolest parts of the song and, like, emphasized the dumbest part. You know? So it gets kind of opinionated.
Then you have a three-minute song. You're like, well, that's cool, but...
Yeah, so, I mean, it's dangerous, but... remixes, I guess. That's why it's dangerous.
Walking a line.
Yeah. So, I mean, it is kind of more cover territory, really. You're kind of covering yourself in a weird way. So let us go back in time first before we dive into the new one that I know everyone's dying to hear Donald's opinion of in particular. But Torn Down, before Torn Down, we went back to 1990.
Sheesh.
All the way back, and this is a kind of bittersweet time, more so than the album, even, I think, just right out of the bat saying, was just
nostalgia.
Nostalgia, you know? If you've been following us and all our gushing of Disintegration, you knew that we'd be pretty in deep at this point. Mixed Up technically would be, if we follow our timeline of new albums that you're a diehard fan when it comes out, this would probably be your first one that you were a full-fledged Cure fan when it came out, because, like... Disintegration was after, so that's cool. That's gotta mean a little more personal to you than
Mixed Up for me back in the day was
a big deal.
to equate it to sex.
Mm-hmm.
It's like Disintegration was like fucking, you know,
mm-hmm.
And then Mixed Up was like getting a boner again, like two boners in one sex sesh. You know what I mean? Like,
okay.
Because it was like, it was that fresh and just like, fuck yeah. Like, I was really stoked on Mixed Up.
Yeah.
When it came out. Like, this shit blew my mind. I loved the artwork and like,
yeah.
I didn't know shit about like electronic shit at the time.
Mm hmm.
So it was kind of like, my first like introduction to electronic beats and shit like that.
Yeah.
And it did kind of blow my mind. Yeah. And I'll always have a special second boner place in my heart for mixed up.
Yeah.
Even though it was kind of silly. Like, there's some songs that are just like, why do I need this like extended fascination streak?
Right.
You know, like it's already tedious.
Yeah.
Like, why do you,
like, not exactly, you know? Like, it was a short, snappy song like we were talking about. You know, it was like the fucking thing was already like 6 minutes long.
Yeah, I know. You just made things more tedious. Like, thank you.
It's great. But, Yeah, and it's something I kind of touched on in the last episode of, with Never Enough, of just how it almost seems weirder now, like when we're especially doing this podcast and really dissecting everything chronologically and and like just mixed up in general. Because I kept reading that, and I remember even as a kid, like getting mad at reviews where it was a pretty decisive or divisive album in that way, where it was, it got mixed up from reviews, you know, and people didn't really know what to make of it. But seeing it now,
and I get that shit now.
Yeah, and it's cool because it totally fits with what we talk about pretty much every album with Robert finding a way to throw off the trajectory of the career at that point, because, you know,
just trying to sink the ship.
They are just different, you know, like nobody expected it. And like with all the hoopla,
he was all big, like this is dick deep and like we like playing stadiums.
Yeah.
And like Eddie was like purposely trying to like sabotage shit. Like,
well, maybe not even sabotage, but it's just weird because the end of Disintegration got so much like buzz of this is the end. It was such a heavy album. You know, he's saying we're not going to tour again. Yeah, where does it go from here? Our career's blowing up. It was supposed to be the album that got them back to their roots and make everybody hate them again, but it was their biggest selling album, and now more people love them than ever. So, he's not going to put out Wish in a year. You know, if he had, that would have been the obvious thing, but no, he puts out this weird ass, you know, like dance mix album, and it was
conflicting.
Yeah, and I don't think it was quite as. I think it really was him just doing something like, different, because it did sound
never
like,
enough.
Yeah, and I touched on it in the Never Enough episode, but it was weird. I didn't recognize. Apparently, there was a session right because they did, which kind of already called bullshit to their calling it quits after Disintegration. When you really look at the timeline, it was like. The tours all ended by, like, you know, I don't even know where, early 90.
They were just tired.
Yeah, and then they put out, like, Entreat, and then they put this out, like, in the same year. So they clearly weren't, like, quitting, you know. I mean, it was, like, you know, just totally, you know, the band was still going full throttle at this point. But yeah, they apparently went into the studio with Mark Saunders, who ended up doing the remixes, some of the remixes on Mixed Up, and recording, they said, about 4 songs on their disasters. And that's when he just wrote Never Enough that night as like a quick, like, fuck it, let's just crank out a rock song. And it worked so much better than whatever they were trying to do. But trying to work in that electronic field gave him more the idea of, you know, like, commissioning out these remixes and just doing a remix album. So who knows, that 4 songs could have been like a whole new direction for the band where they started to do more electronic stuff, which kind of would have been rad, but yeah, it's hard to say. And then like with the whole like Baggies, you know, scene and everything, that's why I didn't really catch on for Never Enough, that maybe that's all those kinds of songs they were trying to do were all the, you know, like In Spiral Carpets kind of shit, you know, where it was gonna be a little more like and stuff, and maybe that would have worked.
No way, that's what they were going for. Like,
I never know if it was. Yeah, so not with this album, but
that
yeah,
was a fucking swing and a miss, man.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's more of like a nod to it. I don't think they're really trying to dive into that genre by any means, but it's been pretty confirmed that's what he was at least in the air enough where he was inspired by it to give it a more of a funky jam guitar rock as opposed to just straight up. Because it did get kind of mutated over the years into like Show where Never Enough started to sound a little more like just distortion-y rock, you know, like when it starts getting more Nirvana-y sounding, you know. But like if you listen to the recording, it is very like a lot of cool slides and wah stuff going on. It's like, oh yeah, I guess that is going on. But and then it just gets back to like doing straight up remixes, I think. But they got these, you know, some bigger names for Mixed Up, you know, and something we can tap on for sure with Torn Down, where this was more finding some people that he was cool on in the electronic field more and stuff, like William Orbit and Mark Saunders. Who are the other ones? Brian, something I didn't jot down, but some of the bigger ones, Oakenfold or whatever.
Like Paul Oakenfold.
Yeah.
Like he actually got some good.
Yeah, yeah, for the time.
Like that Willie Morbid dude.
Yeah.
Some, like, so, yeah, some Madonna some remixes.
Some big ones for sure, yeah.
But they've done some, like, some cool shit.
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit of cred. So, yeah, it's a strange album, and I think it was clever and more in hindsight of how it threw off what they were supposed to do. And a lot of people, I remember even seeing interviews as a kid where Robert Smith was kind of taken aback by, like, well, why are people being so pissy about this? It isn't necessarily what the band's going to do next. It was just like it's just a remix album. And I think the huge thing to remember when Mixed Up was that, like, the bulk of it was already done. I mean, from those singles from the Entreat thing, like all the Disintegration ones, yeah, minus Pictures of You, and I'm sure that was probably done around then. I don't know if they really did it separate, but you know, Lullaby, Fascination Street, you know, those were all like already done, you know, in that manner.
Did it sound the same? Like,
yeah, I think they're the exact same ones.
Even though I do like the Mixed Up version of Lullaby more than the...
Yeah, you like that one better?
Yeah, but,
huh.
Yeah, weird. And I don't like the song that much.
Huh? Yeah, because you're pretty hard on that one in the Disintegration. Because to me, I would think you'd really hate it because it just like goes on like twice as long. And
it's just mixed really well. Like, yeah. There's like little tricks in it, but like Close to Me is,
yeah,
like my favorite one from that. It sounds so
I
good.
I think that one arguably might be a better one for me. Or I don't know. It's like a different, it feels happier.
I like the OG version, but like, yeah, that's my favorite song of the, I love the bass line on it.
It's got like a awesome. That was great. Making swingy. Good choice making that a second single again, and the whole video helped with the part two video and stuff. But Yeah, I mean, like, I guess a quick run through with that. Well, let's just go through the track by track because it's kind of, you know, the essence of what we're really talking about here with Mixed Up. And so Close to Me is the second track, and that is just like, I think it does make it happier. It doesn't really have like kind of that sad claustrophobic feel that maybe the one on Head on the Door does,
it's like
the original.
It's
this one feels a little more like, you're like, fuck it, you know, I should have stayed asleep, but you know, I'm dancing instead. So I don't know, but I dig it. And sometimes I have, that's the only one, I think, even between this and Torn Down, I might as well go on the record where I like a lot of them and I don't like some, but I don't think any of them really are like better than, you know, I've never really on any of them like chose to put any remix version on a mix for somebody over an original, which, you know, maybe that's not the goal. I don't know. But like, it's just weird.
The originals.
Yeah. So, I mean, but maybe that's just
I've never heard a remix.
Yeah. But any song.
Just with any band.
Yeah. 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 For a long time with Substance, I kind of felt like, but
bar some electronic shit, like I've never
it's just too much. I don't know, but I don't know. Moving on, then it goes into Fascination Street, which has some cool parts that aren't in the original
song. It's
just
a longer version of the song.
Yeah, because they didn't really swap out the beats for a lot of those extended
ones.
No, it's
the
like
same
a,
thing.
Yeah. Which
just exaggerated drum sounds.
Yeah.
And then longer like bridges and choruses.
Like I said, and a lot of them were kind of long songs to begin with, so I don't really. But it is cool. Like I said, if you go out somewhere and you hear it, because then you know you'll be listening to it for twice as long, so that's kind of nice. I've been in that environment where I'm like, oh, weird choice that they chose the mixed up version to play at this bar, but at the same time, I'm like, cool, that means at least the next 15 minutes I'll be listening. Not that long, but you know what I mean.
And I love, like, I really love electronic music and listen to a lot of it.
I guess it should be noted that you're definitely more in that vein than me. Especially anything, like full on electronic stuff. I'm like, I'm cool with it, but it's not really my thing quite as much by any means.
Yeah, like for example, I've been revisiting a lots of like early 90s like jungle and drum and bass and stuff, like raw shit from fucking England, you know, like, and I've always listened to shit like this, and like, and revisiting like Mixed Up.
Yeah.
And I've listened to it forever, but it's just like, it's so different than all the good electronic music that I listen to.
Yeah.
Like it's not an electronic album.
But you still even wonder, and that's maybe the saving grace and one of the main faults in both of these is just you don't really know what they're, you know, it's not trying to be an electronic album so much. I mean, half the songs are just, so half of them are just extended mixes, but yeah, but you don't really know. Maybe it is. Like, I don't know what the, you know, it is.
Nostalgia, like, aside. You yeah. know, like, it's a weird call. Like,
yeah. And just weird song choices, too. It's just kind yeah. of a weird flow.
It's like fucking in between days and shit. It's
yeah,
like,
yeah. We'll get to that in a minute.
What are you going to do to that?
Yeah, good thing to note, actually, is every song on Mixed Up is a single. So that's yeah. something we'll get back to. But
I kind of see that. Like, that yeah, makes a little sense.
And it makes sense. And it's very, like, current. Heavy, like Disintegration, you know, is like real big. Disintegration and Kiss Me heavy, so they didn't really even go back and do too many. The next one in our list even is one of the few ones where they do kind of go back. The Walk, which you would think would be super easy and awesome, the remix, but I don't like the remix of this at all. The,
no, neither
like,
do I.
It's just like
it's one of my favorite songs.
Yeah,
too,
it seems like it would be cool, but yeah, it just seems a little overkill on this remix. Yeah, maybe something really different, but I don't know.
I didn't get down on that one. Yeah, it's kind of dumb. Like.
Followed by Love Song is the last of the Disintegration ones, I think.
That's the dumbest. It's one of the dumbest ones. It sounds really? Just the fucking same. It's just a dumb drum beat.
Yeah, I think it works better than, even though Lullaby has the derps, which changes it up a little bit, but I think Love Song has such cool parts that singling it out works better. So I catch myself listening and enjoying that more than the Lullaby one, but I totally agree. It's like not necessary if I ever want to hear yeah. Love Song. I just want to hear the normal version, you know, and... And A Forest is after that, which is like The Walk. The big scoop on that was apparently the old reels or something were either lost or so they re-recorded those two, The Walk and A Forest, which is weird because nothing's ever come up on the new one of like there's shit that's older than both those. So I don't know if they had to re- it didn't sound like it. It sounds like the old like vocals and stuff before we totally dive into Tore Down. But yeah, Forest, it works good. I think Forest is one of those songs that there's been a billion other remixes since and yeah, in between, totally. And it's just one of those songs that's kind of robotic anyway, and so I think it totally caters to this. I like the remix of this. Maybe
I
on
like
occasion.
I like the old.
Yeah.
Like the old extendo mix of A Forest mm-hmm. more than this one.
Yeah.
Like, if we're going to judge remixes, if we're going to... I'm surprised The Forest isn't on this new one.
Yeah, why not? Just keep remixing
just
that song
do it again,
forever.
Assholes.
Yeah, because like, yeah, then it was like that Blake and somebody did like a whole like fucking album of it, you know? Or just like how many remixes of this thing do I need?
But it's like it's a really good song, but I get it.
Yeah, and like, I think it just caters well. Even when people cover it, they tend to make it more. Like a remix, I feel like, because it's easier yeah. to do it in the, you know, just like, it's funny how
it's
many,
built for it.
Yeah, how many covers of it. So that ends side A of Mixed Up, and side B, and this one's grown on me. Maybe I just, because I love Pictures of You so much that I always was like, ugh.
Sheesh.
But this one's the dub mix, so maybe going back to your dub idea, it's like, it's actually kind of cool, but so when re-listening to it this time around, yeah, because normally I'd be like, no way, don't mess with it, but I kind of dig it. Not nearly as good as the original, of course, but
you just love that song way too much. Like, you just
yeah,
hear
I'll hear
it
any
form.
Pretty much. So maybe that's what it is. But
it's not bad, but it's kind of dumb. Like, I wouldn't put it on now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I want to listen to Pictures of You.
Yeah.
I mean, I want to listen to Pictures of You like the regular version right now. I've listened to it a million times.
Why would I ever want to?
Let alone, like, the fucking dub mix of it.
Yeah.
Like.
But it's cool in the sense that that was one that wasn't included. Of the Disintegrations ones, that one wasn't a B-side prior. So that was kind of cool. So I don't know. If it was something that, yeah, I don't know if it was something they just held on to or if it was something they did specific for this, but
they were sitting on it.
Yeah, they're like, this is gonna be the jam. And then this has got to be the most painful part of Mixed Up for you when it does back to back extended Hot 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 and extended Why Can't I Be You.
I know,
so it's like a good 15 minutes of your two favorite songs, and I think we've devoted enough time to if anyone's just joining us for the first time, Donald has a fairly extreme hatred for both these songs. I think I try to defend them and come back while they're not my favorites, But funny, in that idea, when I was listening to it this time, I was like, it's like, I do like Hot, Hot, Hot. I always go back and forth
Shut
on
up.
It. But then, but any hatred I have of Hot, 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 which there is some,
You're
you know.
You're fucking with me, man.
I'm on your side almost for this comment. I think any hatred I have of Hot, Hot, Hot comes from mixed up because this version drives me so fucking crazy. It's so long. Like, you take the, it just really goes on and like a song that should not be that long. And you know what I mean? Maybe it's because I kind of didn't really love it anyway, but it was just kooky and weird enough.
It drags out all the terrible aspects of the song longer.
It's just so long and won't end. And the thunders comes. And I remember, I think it's on Pitcher's show, like the follow-up videos, they use the remixes for the videos on that. Like whatever you saw on MTV weren't, I might be wrong here, but something we had where it was the videos. And I remember watching, because I love like watching the videos, but it was like, even in the video, I'm like, oh God, this is so long. And like, and then going right into like, why can't I be you? It's just like, oh,
like,
it's
God,
so
damn
hard.
It. Like,
so like, I think I was officially cool with Hot, Hot, Hot until this long version came around. And like, from about that moment on, I was always a little, I don't know. I think
it's like getting hit by a car and then stepping out of your car and then you get hit by a car.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, God damn it. Like, you're like, bow, bow.
Maybe,
like,
maybe it's just a 1-2 punch, but I don't know if you spaced them out, like, maybe it would be worse. I don't know, but and Caterpillar comes up next, and that's kind
of
like,
why those two songs though? Like, of all their whole catalog,
yeah,
what you could do with it. Like, if he really wanted to get weird and dip into shit,
yeah,
there's
I don't think they did
a treasure chest of fucking beautiful things you can mine,
and we didn't have the time to
the
really
dumbest fucking shit. Like, I don't,
yeah,
it's baffling to me, man. Like, I don't get it. Like, in the care mm-hmm. that they put into like the initial recordings, you know, like,
yeah, ah,
like
it is true.
He's like,
yeah, I'm looking at
like,
the liner
I did acid
notes
for 2 years and you know,
I got something that might help their case.
Fucking faith in like. And they have all of that, and then they choose to remix songs that sound like fucking remixes from the beginning.
They
like,
didn't, though. Let's hit the brakes for a sec, because I do remember this. That's why...
Hot, 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 come on.
Hot, 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 and Why Can't I Be You were the extended mixes that were done in 87, I think. Yeah, 87. Or maybe not Hot, Hot, Hot. Oh, yeah, 88. So, yeah, it was. There was the extended mixes that were on, like, the dance, you know, like the 12-inch singles.
Yeah.
So they were... They were just ones they had, so they didn't remix them for mixed up. It was shit they just had. So
that's
yeah,
true.
So they,
I see
yeah.
what you're
saying. So I mean, it's like that
they just
and
had them laying around.
Yeah, that mixed in
but
with
they still
the
did dumb shit.
So that kind of makes
that was it, just that song.
Yeah,
like they did some dumb shit on this record.
But yeah, next song in particular, Caterpillar, is like fucking beautiful song. I love that almost up there with Pitcher's E. So I'm happy just to hear it. But this is a kind
right.
of stupid, pointless. It's just pointless, you know. I mean, it's like it's cool just to hear it, but I don't know.
Yeah.
It's not adding anything, but it's still not nearly as insulting as the next one. The only one I straight up hate on Mixed Up is In Between Days. Jesus Christ. What the
so
fuck?
Stupid.
Like, why would you
why
even.
That song?
Yeah,
why
just,
that
you
one
take
is
this
like
cool
the most
rock
unremixable.
Song. Yeah, it's just it's so dumb. Like, I don't know. And like, and you could tell that's probably why it's the second to last song buried on it. You know, they're just like, I don't know. It's In Between Days. People love the song, you know? And. Which does kind of prove the strength of the actual song is that you can fuck with it and it still doesn't
Sheesh.
Totally ruin it. You know, if you heard that the first time, you'd still probably be like, wow, that's a cool song, but.
Yeah, it's a really good song. Why does it sound stupid?
Pretty much. But yeah, the Shiver mix, not a fan. So sorry, guys. But can't all be gold. But. And I guess topping it all up with Never Enough, I didn't get your opinion for the last episode, so we already kind of went into the Madchester baggy version that, you know, you're still not sold on. So, just in general, what do you feel about that song? I think it was pretty rad from the get-go. Like, it's kind of worn off a little bit over the years in my love, but
yeah, I feel the same way. Like I did. Like, that's a fucking guitar, like, that's a riff, man.
Yeah.
That's a good beat, a good fucking riff. Like, I can't hate on the remix version
too much. Yeah, and the remix version of this is just kind of like a big... I
like the remix one. It's a little jammier. You know, like.
It's almost better than the other one, or at least it's just a fatter one. Not, no pun intended with it being called the big mix, but it is just, there's just more of
just
it.
It's a little beefier.
It's like an Oreo big stuff versus a regular Oreo. Yeah,
double
like,
stuff.
Nobody's going to really complain that there's a little more filling.
It's just like more of what I like.
Yeah.
Totally. Like,
because that was a big deal. Like when that video came out and everything, I remember it was such like, holy shit, new direction. I don't know. They weren't. You know, it was just kind of cool to see that they weren't doing Disintegration 2.0, as we've said a bunch of times in other albums and stuff, where it's nice, especially as a kid, to see that your heroes are still cranking out some shit that keeps you on your toes, and you know what I mean? It's just like you didn't really know where that was coming from. Maybe not.
Or it's a sign of the decline of the band.
Yeah, some people are citing that as the turn. But, yeah. I don't know. Going into Wish after that, you can't. Even that's where I guess I just disagree. But yeah, I was
nostalgia,
like, yeah,
nostalgia version of
I'll
me.
I'll start Wish. Leaning
it was,
with
it was
the negative,
like Wish coming out, but like older me, maybe a smarter,
wiser, mature.
maybe not wiser, but you know, looking back at Wish, it was like, I don't know.
Huh. Well, we'll revisit that again coming up. It's almost time.
I'm just saying.
We'll save it for then. all right, here it goes. that's mixed up, man. I don't know. Maybe we breezed through it too fast. Any other thoughts? We have friends that are in down with it. It was just one of those albums that was around a lot, too. Like, our friends all played it. We played it a lot, considering it was just kind of a filler album. And
my heart's like pitter-pattering.
Just thinking of those old days. Are you just having a heart attack?
I just fucking my arm feels weird. I got a numb arm.
Cool. Keep rolling, man. This will be great. Be great for the podcast ratings. I killed Donald with the mixed up episode. Finally
like,
did it.
So bad I died.
You're just trying to get out of talking about any of the later albums.
So bullshit.
You're just trying to get me to kill you off so you don't have to talk about fucking Wild Mood Swings. I see what you're doing. Just like dropping hints of bad health like that a few albums before. You're in it for the long haul, man. You got... Well, I guess just to wrap up mix up then, how do you feel? Are you more when you listen to it now, does the sentimental value still hold enough in your heart, or you consider it, how often do you put on mixed up is what, I guess what I'm getting at, is it something you still like?
It's probably like once a year, like it's like a holiday album, like a Christmas album, like it's just pure nostalgia, like,
right,
you know.
It's, yeah, I can't
I
really
don't
say
get down
I
to
honestly.
It. Like, I don't fucking do a couple bong rips and chill out to mixed up, you know?
Mm-hmm. Like. Yeah, I think like occasionally I'll tap back into it just to pull Never Enough out because sometimes that bigger mix, you know? But like, yeah, it is pretty much only when I've exhausted certain songs so much or albums that I'm like, wow.
Like, I'm bored.
I want to listen to The Cure so bad, but I've listened to all these albums so much. You know, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But it's cool to have the choice and have the variety. So,
like, there's like a hint. Like, I can't think of any, like, remixy, like, remix albums that I would put on before the, like,
before
originals, you know?
And oh, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like, it's... I never think to put them on.
Yeah. For a long time, Substance, New Order, just because I... Yeah, Substance for New Order was close just early on because I don't know why.
I keep forgetting Substance is...
Remixes. Yeah, they're long.
But that
long,
is...
But
that's
a good one.
Actually,
so.
I retract what I just said because that is one of the best...
I don't
records,
know why. Yeah, as a kid, for some reason, we kind of... It was like a
like,
greatest hit.
Nailed that shit.
But even those, like, with Perfect Kiss, it gets into, like, the frogs and shit. I'm just like, is there just, like, a normal version of it? Like, it almost took, like, a lot of years later before I was just... I just kind of... I think I listened to Substance before a lot of the actual albums so much.
Oh, me too. Yeah.
So I was just kind of like, that's the song, you know, but
that's what I knew of New Order was fucking Substance before like I dug into like all this shit and like and Movement.
Yeah.
God damn, is one of the best fucking records. Yeah. Best fucking records.
Once you kind of realize there were like actual versions of those songs.
That's what a remix. That's what a fucking remix album can take you to. Mm-hmm. Like, it led me to that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And hopefully, like fucking mixed up or fucking turned
which is great
up,
point
turned
to
on
wrap
or
up.
Turned down or whatever.
Yeah, like, yeah. Well, boner. Before we move on to the new one, I think that's a great wrap up point.
Hopefully, that leads someone back to fucking faith. You know what
totally.
I mean?
Totally. Or just even while wrapping up Mixed Up, I think in that era of like their success and breaking through with Disintegration so much and so many people probably bought Mixed Up, I'm sure there's tons of our friends even that probably got Mixed Up before, you know, so like
fucking
the first time.
Anything else. This is the first thing they fucking heard, man.
Yeah, so probably hearing that version of A Forest might have been like the first time they heard A Forest or something,
and,
you know.
And
like,
that happens when like a band has been around for like 20 years at that point or some shit, you know what I mean? Like, they're due a greatest hits or a remix. Like, they're the Eagles at that point, you know?
Yeah, maybe. Not that bad. That's kind of harsh.
Fleetwood Mac. I'll cut him a fucking deal, but, like, it's around that time in a band's career when they put out, like...
Yeah, it's strange.
And,
so,
and you can't fault them.
Nah.
I don't fault them. It's not
it would be a little
thing.
Weird. You would think some bands would be a little sensitive about that idea of, like, you're not hearing the real version of the song first, but maybe they're just so happy if anyone's buying a new album that they don't give a shit at that point. But,
here's a shitty version of In Between Days. Yeah, like, that's crazy.
Yeah, I'd be a little weirded out if I was Robert Smith thinking that maybe somebody heard, like, the remix version of In Between Days or Caterpillar before hearing the real one, you know? It's like, oh. But
yeah, I seriously, because Caterpillar is like perfect. Like, it's such a sweet, soft song.
Yeah, and you know, there's nothing really against that remix, but it just is not nearly as cool and organic as the real one, you know. So, but anyway, so let's jump quite a bit of years. You always gotta wonder when, like, a movie waits a long time for a sequel, you know, something's up. But this is kind of maybe not even the idea of the for a long time with the many Robert Smith projects that always like get like teased over the last 10 years in particular, is always like saying there was a Mixed Up 2.
Keeps getting longer and longer when he puts shit out.
Yeah, well, it took forever, but it's not like he kind of just cranked these out in the last, like, year or so. Like,
sounds like it.
But Record Store Day 2018 brings us in our time machine to Torn Down, the long-awaited, maybe, I don't know, nobody was really asking for it, but it was here it is, Torn Down, another remix album. This time, a couple unique spins, and released this last Record Store Day, and... all the remixes, so a couple of big things right out of the gate, I guess we should address if anyone isn't familiar, the differences between Mixed Up and this. Main differences being technology has come a long way. Robert Smith does all the remixes himself, as opposed to, like we're saying, on Mixed Up, actually kind of commissioned out, you know, some people that he probably admired and were some bigger names at the time. And the other big one on this is that it's not singles. There's only two singles on Torn Down, as opposed to all the other tracks of the 16 tracks. So it's a lot more tracks,
God
too. So
damn,
maybe
there's a lot.
Maybe, and there's a good reason for that. So you'll probably harp on the fact that there's too many songs on it, but there's a cool reason for that. So of the 16, they're deep cuts, like. Some are real fucking deep.
Like Cockatoos?
Cuts. Like, yeah, I mean, just they're not even kid. Just... Some are kind
Jesus
of like second tier
Christ.
Would-be singles, and some are like deep, deep cuts. So that on the surface, just initial response. I did it. I told my whole story how I went in there and finally got it, got the damn record. And
I'm limbering up, man.
You're warming up, pacing around. Whoosh. I'm cool with it. I think it's Jesus. On par with Mixed Up. I'm not crazy about Mixed Up, and I'm not crazy about this, but I'm definitely in the vein where I'm clearly in the honeymoon, or what do you call it? Honeymoon period, where I'm just so happy to have something new that I'm like, yay! But at the same time,
went to record store, like you stood in line, like
So it's an experience, I wasn't really as grueling as I'm sure a lot of people went through for it.
Sounds
but,
terrible.
It was
I stood in
pretty,
line for 20 minutes.
Pretty
fuck.
Painless. Paying the $37 was the most painful part, really. Being a tight budgeted old man at this point, I was like, oh Jesus, man. But I'm glad to have it. It was a special moment on his birthday, and it aided to our celebrations we did here. But at the same time, it was and it's cool to listen to. I really honestly do enjoy it, but I mean, it goes back to my point of Mixed Up. Even it's like none of these come anywhere close to the songs, the originals. I mean, in a sense that they're songs that we've been listening to for so long. So I'm like, oh, it's a good fucking, it's a great song. I adore like every one of these songs. And I think that's where it beats Mixed Up is that I love that he took the deep cuts, you know, because it's like, I honestly feel like this even proves whether you like the mix or not, you can't fuck some of these songs up no matter what you do to it. It's just a cool fucking that's song. And
if that's the best thing you'd say about a record, like, they're so good no matter how bad you make them, they're still good.
I don't know. I mean, it's not really how bad or how good you make it. It's just like if you did anything to it, I mean, it's not going to be better than the original, but at the same time, it's like such a good song. But I love it because, I mean, the thing that while you love the beats and stuff, I always hone in on just the songwriting. And like, I feel like this showcases that on a lot of these. I'm like, man, that is just a fucking great written song. Like, even though I don't even really particularly enjoy listening to this version of it, I can still like love and adore this song. And just the lyrics still give me tingles and just hearing it, you know, in some variation. You know, I'll never put this on a mix for somebody as the, well, here's the strange day that you really should hear. You know, it's just, I never would feel that way.
I know, like, here's the cure you want
to. Yeah, I mean, it's not even a knock towards it because like we were saying with Mixed Up, I don't even know if it's, you know, it's not supposed to be that way. He probably wouldn't even tell anybody that, no, this is fucking better, you know. He's just like, this is what he's doing. He's sitting around. He's got the skills and the technology and the fucking rights to the track, so why not, you know? I mean, it's a little bit of a bummer in the sense that, you know, that we have to wait in between Cure releases at this point, you know, so it's probably not like at the top of my list of something I would want to wait 10 years since the last album to hear. But
I know,
I'll take it, you know. And you know, in a certain degree, maybe it's better than putting out a new album because I do already love all these songs. And even if they're not my favorite versions of it, you know, I think there's a lot to be said for that because it's like, all right, going into it, I already know that I love this song. So let's hear something different.
See, and, like, it's...
sorry I had to ramble and just kind of get all that positive shit out.
It seems like it... I'm going to sum up what you're saying. Like, this record sounds like it was fun to make, and it's a cool idea, and I'm sure it was so fun for him to do all this, but it's not fun to listen to. You know, where it's, like, good for him, but, all right, like.
I wonder how much is just, like, this is how he just normally would spend the weekend anyway, and he's just like, all right, fuck it. Like, how much work really went into it, or I don't know. But
like, I think he worked hard at it, you know? It's a lot of work. If I were him, that sounds like a lot of fun, like, fucking with my songs, like.
Yeah.
But it's like, Dad, what are you doing? It's like, I'm remixing my songs.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's not like the originals are going anywhere.
It's the dad shoe of the Cure
album. You can't blame the old man factory because it's Mixed Up, you know? He's like,
he's a big old goofy pair of fucking New Balance.
No, you can't play the dad card there. But,
he's like 60.
He's not even a dad. He's just old. Can't blame him for living.
No, you can't, but it explains a lot.
Yeah. All right, well, let's dissect and get a little more pinpoint, because yeah, I mean, that being said, like I said, I love the songs, but there's certain ones I definitely like better than others. There's certain tricks that I noticed in his style, and that's kind of what I'm more curious of, like, because you do like the electronic stuff a bit more, of just the approach he took for all of them. And you know, we'll kind of do the rundown of the songs, but yeah, I don't know. It's weird that the love is there, and I think it's better taking deep cuts, because singles, it's like so much of mixed up. I don't want to listen to it ever. One, because I'd rather listen to the real songs, but two, it's like those singles. It's like I've heard those so many times. Like even when I'm throwing those albums on, it's just like they're the ones that just got
in between days. Like
why would you do that? Like, yeah, like why pick that and hot? I just never really need to hear unless it's in the
it seems like such the obvious, but it's such a
yeah.
goofy
and at the
idea.
Time, it didn't make sense because they were still kind of pushing. That's a variation of getting a greatest hits out without putting a greatest hits out, and you know, and it's like Disintegration wasn't that, you know, it was new at the time when Mixed Up came out, so those songs were all still pretty fresh, you know. So you could milk that.
Do you think that Mixed Up was like he had control of what got put out? Was it like some label shit?
Nah, I think he was cool with that, because I think he was smart too in saying, like what we said earlier, like it made sense in their career at this point. Like if he put out a deep cuts up to 1990, then nobody would have fucking cared at all. Like, you know what I mean? It's like the diehard fans would have been like, yeah. But I mean, it's like, but 1990, yeah, I mean, they were still at that point where they're all like, let's cash this out. But not in like a nasty way. It was just like, it was, like I'm saying, like while Morrissey at that time was putting out like a greatest hits that just had like one new song on it, you know, like that kind of crap bugged me more as a fan than this. It was like them doing something sort of different and probably reeling in tons of new fans at the process.
Does make sense.
Yeah. And by them doing like the deep cuts on this, I don't know. I think it just like it's cooler because it's old songs that you already love, but it's not really obviously trying to win over any new fans or anything, you know. It kind of just does show that funner side of it, you know. And they're not really ones that people would be like, oh, what the fuck. Maybe to a certain degree, but not like, I don't know. So I think it was great choices.
The song choices are crazy good.
Yeah. Like, yeah. And that's the best part.
Like that's what, like, I did get a little excited for a minute when I heard about this, just when I saw like what he was remixing. Cause it's like, all right, like some deep cuts, boy. Like, let's see what's going on. And
the pattern of it being one from every album, that's why it's 16, you know, like why it is a little overly long. You know,
I didn't catch on to that.
Yeah, it's one from every album, and then but then they're kind of being like throwing Never Enough. And
I feel like we should buzz Chaz in here. We're talking about numbers.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, do the math.
We're doing math here. Where
they're counting just Japanese whispers, so that's usually left out of the 13 albums.
Yeah,
and
dude.
And they're counting Cut Here and Never Enough, which were the new songs on the greatest hits and Mixed Up. So so that's why it's a little longer, but I think that's cool. And that was a cool concept, you know, to show a little love to even the new albums, you know. So, but we'll get to that. Your initial thoughts there. Do you want to just come out blazing with something?
Yeah.
Sorry, I rambled.
Well,
I just
wanted to
make sure I got some shit on the record before.
I'm about to forget something poignant. I wish they made this record, like with this track listing.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the 90s when they
with the other mixers and stuff,
like with when Mixed Up came out, I wish they did this track listing with those artists at that time. Not
so with like William Orbit and shit doing Just One Kiss and stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like I wish they did this record back then.
I agree to a certain degree, but like we just said,
like, I would almost prefer to hear those songs remixed now.
Yeah, from Nick's career stuff. Wise, like, though, that you know, been
like
dumb.
I'd almost like to, I'd almost like to hear a fucking In Between Days Now, remix.
Yeah, true. Yeah, if they'd flipped it, maybe would have been like, yeah, what the fuck would he want to add to In Between Days Now? Would be more interesting than what he would want to do in 1990. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it just doesn't logically, you know, career wise, they were blowing up. Why would they do it? But at the same time, yeah, that would be pretty rad.
That's my take on this whole thing. I have nothing else to add, so I'm just gonna bad boy.
And the point I keep getting to make is how dreadful Torn Down would be if it was singles from 90. Like if they did the same approach as Mixed Up for this part two. That would have really... Like if they had taken the prominent singles from Mixed Up up. Like, right. So if they'd just done like a remix of High and Friday I'm in Love and dance dub mix of Letter to
Ladies. Oh, like all their singles and shit?
Yeah, that would have really sucked. So I'm glad that they didn't.
That'd be silly
that,
as fuck, like a Friday I'm in Love.
Yeah.
Oh, that sounds terrible.
I'm sure they could have, and maybe would have even still made more sense commercial-wise. But like, you know what I mean? And then just going into all the singles, even of the later albums and stuff. So I'm very happy that they didn't do that. So.
You'd hear that in grocery stores.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like the 7-minute long version of Strange Attraction? That would have been...
Just that fucking dumb beat over and over again forever.
Anyway. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. I'm sure there is an extended mix of that song out there. But, yeah, so your initial reaction... did you kind of lose it as you were going through the track listing, or was it kind of right out of the gates? You're like, I think I know what I'm in for.
Yeah, like literally from like, through Imaginary Boys made no sense. And I kept thinking like, is he like, you know, like remixing like original sounds that they recorded, or is he re-recording stuff? And like, cause
I think for the most part, like all the core parts, it didn't seem like I didn't catch any like re-recorded vocals even. So I think it's all the original vocal tracks and guitars and stuff.
But didn't sound right, of course,
they're adding like synths and, you know, shit and all that, but
sound like that to me, like,
because his voice sounds crazy young on that first one there. So, but it was weird because they did go out of their way to talk about how much like they lost the whatevers were so old for Mixed Up. So I don't know, but I mean, it's
the tapes of missing.
Yeah, I mean the harmonies are the exact same. There's no way he would nail
like
it.
Christmas, exactly. A Cure Christmas special.
Yeah. We got to save the masters. But I don't know. Did you have an overall thought though, or should we do the track by track and you can kind of?
I don't give a fuck. Like,
yeah. So you're just kind of down all the way through. You didn't like it.
Like,
yeah.
I didn't like the. It sounded dated. And I know it sounds silly that it's remixing a bunch of old songs, but it sounds like
the remix
dated.
Out of it was dated. I mean, or
yeah, just like
so
the,
what he was
the,
doing to it, he should have been utilizing more modern technology,
yes, huh. Or utilizing artists that like can get down on on some beats and some sounds, you know, because it's such a.
I worry that you're dwelling on the fact that he remixed them all, though. I wish you hadn't known that going into it. But do you think that was kind of in your, like, crawl, though, that you knew that it was him? I'm like...
I did go in knowing that, but I would have, like, say if I didn't, I would have picked up on it, like,
pretty quick. Yeah. Because
just, like, the remix of, like, Plain Song.
Yeah.
Oh, we're just like, actually, that was yo, one you
I
missed the
more favorably
fucking...
of. But
no, he missed.
We'll get to that. But
he missed the obvious.
How so?
Obvious things to hit of like what you could do if you're remixing something like from the so many of the songs, like almost all of the songs, is just like missing the fucking obvious. Like, of just,
but maybe he didn't want to go with the obvious.
I guess. I mean. And that's just right, you know? Like,
yeah, man, I mean, like, that's what I guess is the safety net.
What the fuck you want with them, man? Like, that's cool. Like,
and it is the safety net with remixes that you can just pick, because you are just kind of accenting certain parts. You know, I mean, you really could do a billion for each song and, like, showcase one guitar riff a bit more or the bass line a bit more. You know what I mean? So there's no – it's the safety net in the sense that there's no real wrong way, but there's better ways to do it. You know? And it's just like – I could see the wrong side that I'd imagine would bug you, because even being a dude that totally doesn't know shit about electronic music or anything or care that much, but, like, I could kind of sense that some of the beats did seem a little, like, in my vein of boom, chicka, boom, boom, you know, like, I mean, like – yeah, I mean, we're just, you know.
Like, it was like some 90s drum sounds and patterns. And, like, it did get a little hip-hoppy at one point.
Yeah.
I forget which one. Because
there definitely wasn't any more, like, just super crazy chaotic stuff. Not that I would want to listen to that by any means, but it would have been kind of cool just totally destroy one.
Like some
but, like,
Bjork
like,
shit, man. Like,
yeah, or even
like
just,
some
like,
pretty electronic, like, that's what I wanted to hear, like, but yeah, just like some fucking like chill ass, like legit simple electronic shit. And just the only thing I can say that I kind of liked about the record was the vocal mixes and shit. Like,
yeah.
Just it was very layered.
Yeah.
And it was kind of cool.
Yeah, I love like the vocal
that
stuff,
the
but
only
I mean
thing
it kind
of. And I wish there was it was just a record of all of that, like take the drums out, take all these things out, and just like just a badass like layered vocal thing, maybe some strings. Like, goddamn, that would sound pretty.
Yeah,
like, that's kind of what I was hoping for with this remix, where it would be like a stronger take on these songs, because they're all good. Good fucking songs, you know?
And mm-hmm.
It was just...
Because they did kind of seem to take...
Well-intentioned. You know, well-intentioned, but...
Because he did seem to take more of, like, the club mixy approaches as opposed to, like, extended mixes and stuff. So they all did have, like, more of, like, giddy up go kind of drums and stuff. You know what I mean? Swapped out, where I was kind of thinking maybe on a few of them they would... kind of stick with the mixed up approach, where it's just a longer version of the song, which might have been cool to kind of mix and match it, but I don't know, maybe this makes it a little more cohesive too, but I don't know. It is I definitely jotted down a few things as far as like stuff that I thought would bug you and even like
I bet you have like a whole notebook.
Nah, not too much. That would bug me. I just knew you would hate it no matter what, so I didn't really dwell on it.
But... like one page just says water.
Yeah, he'll hate it. Just wanted to piss on everybody's record store day success as fast as possible. But no, it was funny, dude, because you said the vocals. That was one thing I was curious to ask you about, because. It's weird because I noticed it being a trick. He's like, I almost say a few of these is like tricks, because he kind of refers back to like a lot of the same approach on like all these mixes.
Yes.
It was like kind of almost a little too similar from even my taste. You know, I'm like, oh, I'm starting to see the pattern a little bit, you know?
Yeah,
and like,
no, there's definitely, you're right.
And so that kind of bugged me, but I liked the vocals. But at the same time, I noticed it was something that you do not so much with vocals at all, but like even in your own recordings, how you love the delay that kind of eats itself is how the only way I could really describe it. And he does that on like a lot of the vocal parts, which was cool. So I was like curious. It's funny you said
to
that.
A T. Just a delay that eats itself, man.
Yeah, like when you just crank the delay so much, he's like, and then it like bleeds into the next line, and it just starts to get this huge, almost muddy layer of like. The vocals just piling up on themselves, and I loved
it,
but it did start to get a little old by like the you know 10th track or something. I'm like,
it's all he had.
Yeah, it's
on top
cool.
Of
you know,
some dumb drums. Like,
so, but you know, maybe you guys are on the same wavelength more than you think, because he's just like, hey, fucking I. He's like, shaw, shaw, shaw.
Hey, a hack can recognize a fucking hack a mile
smell your
away.
Own, yeah.
What's the easiest way to like
make this sound crazy?
Boys, 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 boys.
Yeah, I'm an artist.
I don't know. I'll let the listeners decide on that. But yeah, I don't know.
But I did like the vocals. That's funny.
Yeah, so maybe it was somehow. But the other one was funny how it seemed like almost. See, I haven't done the math to figure out how many, but like every song seemed to like, and this kind of falls into the harping negative, so I thought you'd like it, but like where he's taking like the last line of a chorus and that's how you start out the song. So there's like so many songs where it's just all like you take like the end of the song, almost like the last thing he says. It's like waiting for the next attack, 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 and then it like pauses or something, and it's like, yeah, then the song kicks in. It's so like it all like, yeah, wow. And they're kind of all just in that like approach. I was like, all right, he comes out blazing with like a vocal thing that isn't the normal first line, you know, and then you're like, whoa, and then it goes into the kind of thing, and it was cool. I mean, I like the first few, I was like, fuck yeah, and then I'm like, oh, again? Oh, all right, one more time. So the same thing. So so that was kind of like him resorting back to what he's doing over and over again, I think. But how about we do the run through then of the tracks, and we can kind of do the pros and cons, or just blaze through them however you want. And then, is that cool? All right, so let's start out with the beginning, going back to the start of it all. Three Imaginary Boys. I like the way, I think it loses steam as it goes, maybe just because some of the tricks or whatever you want to call them, for lack of better terms, kind of just get a little old by the end. But I felt like it starts out strong, maybe just because these old songs are so minimal, you know, and I felt like,
yes,
there was a common thing that I dug with those, with Three Imaginary Boys and M in particular, was how when you throw the, like, just like, I don't even know what you would call it, but it's more of the straight up synthesizer sound of the like the New Order, yeah, kind of, where you're just and sequenced, throwing those in. I wish they would do, yeah, the sequence stuff. I wish they would do that more on all of them, but they kind of used it. He used it where it was like come in on like the second verse or something. I forget which it is for each one, but
Because you can use that on a minimal song. You can't use like that sequence, like bum 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 bum,
right,
on a very complicated,
like, yeah, like
same
Edge of the
deep waters.
Green Sea.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like,
yeah, yeah, for sure. So I liked it on
those.
That's weird,
and that was kind of dope. I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
I did like that in the.
And they're a little more in the camp of like what you were originally saying of like drastically different, because it sounds like nothing like Three Imaginary Boys so much, other than the vocal melodies and stuff. So
yeah,
that was cool. But I could see what you're saying, where if you're not a fan of like the actual beat chosen and stuff, might not be the coolest. You know, like maybe could have done something a little cooler with it. But at the same time, I was cool with that, you know. And
that's my take on that. I didn't like it.
Okay, so thumbs down from the start. Something maybe before we dive into all of them too, they still kept them fairly short. I was happy on that. Like,
yes,
none of these are like drastically long. Edge of Deep Green Sea, we'll get to that one's actually funny and linked. That one's actually shorter. It's like half as short. Like, it's 6 minutes long on this. Like, the real version's like 10.
The remix is shorter.
The remix is fucking shorter. Like, I was cracking up when I realized, I was like, it's like a good like 5 minutes shorter, I think, than the real version. It's because they cut like all the like the instrumental shit.
All the
it just
good
kind of like, yeah, I don't know. But we'll get into the specifics, because I had a few questions for you on that one, because you're always a little critical of Edge of the Deep Green Sea.
But keeping
in context, the bounce back M I was cool on. It might be my favorite on the whole thing. I thought that was cool because maybe it harps back to my kind of wishy washy feelings on the production of 17 Seconds as a whole. But, But I thought it was kind of cool because it seemed a little more aggressive, and I felt like the sequence stuff works a lot better. Three Imaginary Boys, it kind of, I didn't even really realize it was in there until like the eighth listen or something. I was like,
yeah,
oh yeah, it's in that one too. But it definitely seemed a little more prominent in that one, so it was really cool. So I dug M. I thought that was like, if you had to like pick a single close to me style off of this one, that would be the one that you could showcase that was different enough
totally
and kind of cool. So.
But, you know, still doesn't come anywhere near the original, but at the same time, it was cool, you know. So.
But, like, I agree, like, that was probably one of the better ones on the record. Like.
Cool. Yeah. So, we agree. Agreed on one part. Drowning Man, getting into some faith. That was cool that it was so dreamy, but they just kind of made it boring and, I don't know. Just all the way through. Anything in particular? That one I felt like just piled up on itself too much. It was just like, blah, 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 blah. They just kept going with the delay, and it was like,
When I realized the record sucked, like really bad, like, because it's one of the songs. It's like, why would you do that with what you have to work with? Like, like that's the angle you're taking. Like, okay, like. All right, man. Like, you do you, boo. Like,
this is what he heard in his dream or something.
Like, get your life, man. Like, it was cool. Like, yeah, and it's fucking all right.
That one's not really one of my favorites off of Faith, so I was kind of just curious to see. But at the same time, yeah, I don't know. I didn't particularly love it, but at the same time, I wasn't offended by it either. You know, it's like, whatever. But yeah. Yeah. Strange Day is a pretty much perfect song, so it's hard to fuck with, you know, that one's like kind of like messing with a single to a certain degree, where it's like,
you were saying it's hard to fuck up, but
yeah, I don't know, I mean,
that was really dumb, man.
Yeah, I didn't like
the drums sucked, like the drum sounds, like the patter.
I jotted down lots of swirls.
There's the internet. Sure. You can get the drum sound of anything, and you have your original recordings of dope drum sounds, and you find dumber ones to replace the fucking...
So you think they should have just beefed up some lull on that, maybe?
Fuck yeah. Like, I don't know if he did, but like they sounded... He made everything...
This was one, yeah, like some of these get a little
and unnecessary.
Like, and like, I'm not sure this is the best example, but a few of like my kind of complaints are that at a certain point, it just does kind of feel like you're listening to two songs at once. Maybe it's just because I have the originals so like buried in one part of my brain, and I'm listening to something else that's like something. I'm just like,
it's like a mashup.
It's like, I think this fits. It's like those mashups. You listen, like, oh, that's neat that they got it to kind of fit over that, but not really. And it's like it's like staring at the fucking floor long enough, you start seeing shit or something, but I don't know. But I wasn't totally on board with this one, but I think a huge part of that was just because I love the other one so much that it's a little hard to...
Other one's great.
It's hard to tell how much of that is with all these is because you do love the song. So maybe that's the scarier part of picking deep cuts, you know? It's like maybe you're a little more... likely to not give a fuck what they do to Why Can't I Be You, because you're like, whatever. But when they're picking apart songs like that, and the next one, Just One Kiss, was kind of a missed opportunity. I'll take the negative camp on that one too.
Yeah,
anything from Japanese Whispers, I feel like you could do some really modernized cool shit with.
I felt like drag out the original drum, like drum machine beat, like just use that and fuck with it. Like, it's so right in front of your fucking face, like, what to do with that song.
Yeah. Like. Yeah, that was a tough one. It's weird. That one was like, I jotted down that I like it once it all gets going. But, like, when you hear just the beat, I hate it. This was one that I was like, totally like, I know nothing about beats, but I will gladly say that I did not like the beat on that. It sounded like the Escape Club or something almost. It was all like, give me wild sex. What the fuck was that? Escape Club? You know, it was like,
it's like some fucking early 90s shit.
But it was weird. But I mean, once it all got the pieces meshed together, I was cool with it, but like, because they kind of stagger the intro, I think, and I was just like, because once you hear like that weird little whistle, I was just like, enough of a sucker. I was like, all right, you got me, whatever, the song fucking rules, you know. And it's like, But I mean, it's pulling back shit from the other song, so it's not like anything this new song
you're
is like.
Hey, I recognize that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just enjoying it. I'm not like burning my copy of Japanese Whispers or anything.
It's nostalgia, dude. Don't let nostalgia cloud your fucking mind.
For enjoying a variation of a good song.
How dare you enjoy it?
Eddie. Sorry, I enjoyed it. All right,
I enjoyed the past. Okay,
I just like hearing good songs, even if it's 70% of the good song. You know,
or if it's like a worse version,
it's like you know, it's like a really cool person. If they lose an arm, you don't like them less. You know, they're just like not like their whole person. They're still a good person.
No, they're terrible.
Maybe not the best analogy, but. Anyway, let's move on. Unless you got something to add. He's not like pulling a George Lucas where he's going to replace every.
He's put flashlights. Robert Smith is
like, go back and reissue all the albums with these songs on it instead. And be like, whoa, what? So, yeah, that would be terrible. But
this album is going against time.
Nah, not really. I don't think so. It's going to be known as a bonus version of the album. I mean, you can't even count it as an official album. I think we're just so desperate for anything new that we're, you know, nobody will count this as one of the official 13, I don't think. So, I'm not doing it. But, anyway, let's move on to Shake Dog Shake. This is kind of a very... organic rock song that has changed up. They really went crazy with those fills, or he did, I guess. Is that many like crazy fills in the actual song, or maybe they're just in better context in the real song? But it seems like the opening kind of like drum roll fill there is like all over the fucking place on this mix. I don't know why, but I jotted that down. I was like, man, those rolls are everywhere.
Shake Dog Shake is one of the songs when I was a young boy and learning to play drums and listen to The Cure.
Mm-hmm.
Like the top.
Yeah.
Was one of my like practice albums. And Shake Dog Shake fucking blew my mind as a young drummer because the fills are so good and the beat's so dope.
Yeah.
And this song was such a disappointment to me. Like it hurt my soul because I was looking forward, like when I saw the track listing of what they were going to do before I heard it, I was like, fuck it, Shake Dog Shake, fuck yeah.
Seems like that would be a tough one to remix, though. They should have just picked a different
one.
It's
a tough one to fuck up. It's such a good fucking song. Like,
and it's such a kind of a rocking song more. I don't really see adding any like electronic shit to it. It's probably just a bad idea in my opinion. But
my literal notes... I think I said this earlier, but literally my notes on Shake Dog Shake, it sounds like it would be fun to make this.
But not listen to it.
the best thing you could say. Like, it sounds like it would fun to be new. Like, cool. Like, whoop-de-doo. That sounds great for you, man. Like... But, like, how do you fuck up, like, the drums on that are so good? It's the only good thing about the top, to me, is just, like, is the fucking drums are dope. They're recorded so well. Yeah. And there's so many good, like, weird tom-filled kind of beats, you know? And it's like, they do have this song where the only good thing about it is the fucking drums on that are dope.
Yeah.
And he doesn't use it. I don't get it. That's what it, like, it's like, fine, man. Like,
Shake Dog Shake. And unfortunately, I guess I have to go to my strongest fucking negative is coming up right next. How did this turn so negative? I enjoyed listening to this, but now I'm catching your negative vibes. But A Night Like This is the one that I'm definitely like, ugh, I did not dig this mix. Points for trying something a little different because it does change the, like I was saying, there's kind of gets a little formulaic on what he's doing on some of these, but
this one almost takes like a weird ass like 70s disco feel or something almost. And then like, and then they like, whatever the fuck reason, he decides to showcase the sax, which is always like the worst part of like the actual version of A Night Like This, you know. It's like, if there was ever a reason and a good time to re-record a song, it would be A Night Like This, and like taking out the sax and putting the cool guitar solo in there. But nope, they really made the sax prominent on this one. And
because they took the sax out when they played it live, they replaced it with like guitar shit.
Yeah, that's why, like, when they kind of made it the
that tricky old Bob.
Oh yeah, because it's fucking ridiculous sounding. In like 1985, it was great, you know. But like, I mean, it almost gets so like, referring back to our comments on psychedelic furs, it gets like where it's just like, it's just like really showcasing that sax again. I'm like, oh shit, maybe he's onto something. This sax like officially cool again or something, because this is like ridiculous cokehead sounding. I just was like picturing some like John Hughes shit going on or something. I was like, what the fuck, man? And like, just totally take the whole thing out and re-record a guitar solo over that would have been awesome. So I don't know. So I was not like on board
synth,
with that
like
one.
Like a synthy wash, like a washy synth part or something.
Yeah, like, anything. That's why like the show version is
like,
so
heard
cool.
We've heard the saxophone 1,000 times.
Yeah,
like,
we don't need that.
I get down some saxophones, fucking like when used wisely, it's fucking pretty badass, you know.
I mean, it's a decent sax part, but it's just such a cool
song.
It's
melody,
one of my favorite.
You know? It's,
yeah, it's one of my fucking favorite Cure songs, you know. But like, like that guitar solo on Show is like golden, you know. Like, you swap it out for that, you're. That's one of their best songs, you know. But it's like, yeah, so it's just a little sad when you're like, oh, this was like, if there was ever an opportunity too, it's like something like this where you can kind of just take those moments to swap out something that's a little dorky in the song and fix it or whatever, you know, at least try, you know.
And they used the saxophone and they didn't, and he didn't use it correctly. Like, if you're going to use it, like, fucking do it right, you know, remixing something. Like, if you want to bring in the saxophone, like, make it sound cool.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's everything from the original song. And if it's ever going to sound good, I think it would be in that original version. And I don't even think the sax in the original version works so great. But, I mean, it's a great part. But
I like
just,
it. Like,
it's so ridiculous.
I like it in the original. Just, like, it kind of hits.
Yeah. I mean, I guess when you think about it being like a 1985 album. But, yeah, I mean, just for... how timeless that song is otherwise, you know. It's like,
the timeless is a
I'm sure that's a preference. Yeah, it's just a preference thing, so I'll just dismiss it at that. But this one actually did feel kind of what I was saying earlier, where I think by the end of the song, I was kind of like, I literally feel like there's two different songs going on. There's like this like sort of dancey disco song, and A Night Like This is playing in the other room. You know, I'm just like, this is hurting my brain. So I already feel like this is the one I would skip like every listen. So.
Well, that's what I was going for.
Skippability.
Like, you're in a room, it's a party. Yeah. You know, another...
And maybe jumping the gun on parallels, but the fact that In Between Days was the only one that really bugged me on Mixed Up, and this is the only one that really bugged me on Torn Down. So it's like, don't fuck with Head on the Door, maybe. I don't know. Just like, I don't know why, but it's like, all the other ones have a certain degree of, you know, you can fuck with it, but not that album, apparently.
Right.
Like Cockatoos comes up next. Great song choice. That's a good one. Kind of down with this one. It was weird enough where it was like mostly synth stuff going on, and like, I don't know, I felt like they kind of made it like a cool chill version, and it got very like, actually something that kind of goes through a lot of these, where somehow all these songs ended up sounding very like 90s Depeche Mode, you know, which is cool.
Right,
if you're into
it's
that.
Dumb drums.
Yeah, I don't know if it's like, it's funny you saying it sounded like dated drums, but so maybe that has something to do with it. But yeah, to me, like a lot of the songs, they're just kind of overly epic, you know, and like everything's like, like they all sound like they should be like on a like a 90s Batman movie soundtrack or something.
Yeah,
you know,
like that Prince, like that Prince, like,
yeah,
that
like
Prince
everything's
Batman
just
album.
Like a little overly like, you know, even like, you know, like you could almost see like a Crow remix, you know, like Burn remix.
He
everything was just
nailed
like,
it.
Like
it's
those,
the
like,
lead that album.
Like all those late, even like all those, like, you know, songs for like the late 90s, like the X Files one and shit, you know, like some shit that would be like you buy a remix version of it on the soundtrack. And
yeah,
it all kind of fits in that vibe.
Totally. It's just like, calm down. Like every sound you hear, it's just like, yo, like, just calm down.
Yeah.
Like everything's so jumping big, like every little vocal part and like drum sound and just everything was so fucked with. It's just like that fucking Prince, like
Prince production.
Yeah, like where Jack Nicholson is fucking around in like that art gallery and it's just like, you
know. I don't think it's that funky, but yeah, I mean it's
but it's that same attention to detail,
yeah, and that epicness of it. And yeah, it's just like those later Depeche Mode, it feels like, because they're all like where that where they're kind of like almost like the pop industrial music and shit.
Depeche Mode than this, and I don't like Depeche Mode that much.
Yeah, I know. I make it sound like I'm saying that's like a negative thing, but like even I'd rather listen to early Depeche Mode. I guess that's what I'm
getting
at.
Talk them up
like,
that much.
When Depeche Mode tries to sound tough, you know, has never been my favorite. You know, just like just so be a dorky synth pop band. You know, don't try to be badass Depeche Mode, but. Yes. Plain Song, you had mentioned you didn't like that one. That was kind of my next favorite after M, I think, just because I felt like he kind of took a different angle with it, at least, where he pulled all like the synth riffs back, which is like 90% of the song, but it was like fairly cool beat, I thought, like, and just keeping like prominent on the guitar part though, and then like it's almost like the vocals were clearer on this one, so it was kind of cool that it was different. At least it almost sounded like, even though it doesn't come anywhere close to the actual version, it was like you could almost play this for somebody as a totally different song and it would still be cool, I thought. So I was down with that one just because I was like a little skeptical too, because that was one that was like, ooh, what's going to happen here? Don't fuck with this. And I don't know. I was kind of down with that one for some reason. I don't know. So you're just totally anti through across the board?
Yeah. Like, I mean, it's nice that it's on the record. Like, it's a cool song. Like, it's like, what a cool choice. But like, it's an example of swing and a miss. Like, like he missed the obvious of just, if you were to remix a fucking awesome song, like he just missed all the obvious things that one would, you know, like make prominent.
I don't know. I'm thinking like, maybe he did it on purpose. He's sly that way. Maybe he didn't want to go with the obvious.
I mean,
but maybe it didn't work, in your opinion. That's fair enough, too. Yeah, whatever. So
that's
all I'm
really,
like I said, it's kind of the saving grace for remixes. There's no absolute wrong answer because it's not the real song anyway, so it doesn't really fucking matter. but
you're just missing the obvious. You should have called it. That should have been the title, the name of this record is Missing the Obvious. Because all of these songs, like, I'm looking back at my notes because I listened to it once and I made notes. But all my notes are just like, yep, still.
Maybe it'll grow on you. Keep listening. Maybe we rushed this a little too much.
I mean, I'll give another listen, you know, but.
Alright, just throw it on while you're doing the dishes or something. See if
I mean, I'll give it a fair shake, but.
I'm cruising. Anyway, speaking of the weirdness, the next track I was confused about, I didn't go into this in the Never Enough episode. How'd this fucking song get to be on both of them? I feel like that's kind of a weird, I guess people online were saying that just because it defines the era, but I mean, oh, really?
It's double dipping, man.
Yeah, and I mean, and especially if they were
eat
taking
that
some,
whole chip, don't dip it back in.
This is around salsa, when it starts feeling really generic for me, because I was like, well, what is this? I mean, it's like, it's a remix, but it like does absolutely nothing.
A remix of a remix of a remix.
Yeah, and I mean, and the whole point of Never Enough is it's just kind of a cool rock song, you know? So like, why? You know, it's just like,
I'm being cheeky and clever.
Not even that. It's just like, I don't know, it just seemed unnecessary, and you probably could have cut that one because you didn't have to have it in there anyway, because it wasn't
like,
on
what else
the,
are you do with the song?
It wasn't really like, on any of the official albums, so you don't really have to have it on here. So it just seemed, I'd rather hear a Harold and Joe remix, to be honest. It would be cool.
That'd be dope. That would have been dope.
Weird with that. Yeah, because that's a weird song, but
you could slap a crazy beat on that all day.
Yeah, so I don't know, but I was lost on that one. And what about From the Edge of the Deep Green Sea? Because we're going to get into some more. If you've listened back to The Wish, you know, you're always a little thrown off by that keyboard part, the little piano that just goes through the whole thing, and it's still there.
It's just kind of all there.
Yeah, I think they dropped it out in parts of this one, but like we said, it's shorter than the actual mix, and
I'm gonna throw out some conspiracy theory shit, and I think he's fucking with me.
He's fucking with you on that.
Just me in particular with that piano part.
Yeah, he's like,
he knows.
Thought I was gonna drop it out, eh, fucker?
I'll back at you.
I'm gonna make it louder.
But no, this like this remix is goofy, man. It was garbage. It's weird. I didn't like it, man. It's like, why that song?
Yeah. I mean, it's a cool song.
And then, two,
but
why do that to that song?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a guitar-y song. It's a points for challenging himself, maybe.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Like,
but it's just like, but yeah.
Like I've been saying, it's like, I bet this was fun to make, but someone has to listen to this. You know, it's like, good for you. That sounds like a lot of fun.
Anyway, let's move on to your favorite era of The Cure, unless you got anything else to add of substance to Edge of the Deep Green Sea.
No.
No? Yeah. We could blaze through these pretty quick, because I feel like you probably didn't really dive too hard into these. Want from Wild Mood Swings.
Ooh.
Love the song. I don't know. I like this one. It has like a pause after the intro I don't like. But then once it kicks in, I'm into it. So it's pretty cool. But
I made some
part.
Want notes.
Oh, all right. Let's hear what you get.
Want it to stop.
Just like clever insults or with actual notes.
The beat and the string combo is shit.
Okay, well.
I didn't like.
So you might not wake up early tomorrow. Rolling Stone might be calling to hire you to write some reviews. Shit sandwich. I want this to stop.
Shit. Like the mix is dumb. Yeah. Like the strings and the drums were
I don't know. I wasn't insulted by it like all of them, but I think it's a better rock song, or just the guitars and shit are what make that song cool, and the aggression is left out because it doesn't. Yeah. Just totally like, what is this?
I had to Google some of these songs and just like, what album is
it on? Well, as I said, we're getting
like
into
the longer it went on, it was just like, what album?
Yeah, we're in the more recent albums now. So, recent has been 18 years ago. The next track, Last Day of Summer on.
Oh, I'm going to take a piss real quick. I'm going to keep it rolling.
All right. So as you just heard, Donald had to use the restroom right then. I would like to make the joke that he got locked in the bathroom or forgot to come back altogether. But not the case. We had some technical difficulty with him coming back, but fear not, if you've been enjoying riding these negative waves, he does return for the finale of our review of Torn Down. But in the meantime, I'll just kind of plow through the next few tracks. And how convenient, just happens to drop out right at Bloodflowers and misses all the albums up to present day. Anyway, I shall continue on my own then until our finale. Let's continue. Let's move on to another one of your favorite albums, Blood Flowers, which I don't know how you would feel about the original version even, but Last Day of Summer, brilliant song. This is actually my favorite song on Blood Flowers. And I actually like this remix a lot. They kept it cool, and it reminded me that I wish they would have chosen a few more slow jams like this one. It's a nice, sweet, slow song that you can kind of add the little or whatever the hell the beat is, but it doesn't really, they're not making it so Batman epic. Yeah, and I kind of wish they had done that maybe on a few of the other ones, like picked maybe, because it's weird because a lot of the songs they picked aren't necessarily like big poppy ones or big rock ones, but they're still, they just epiced it up so much, like we're saying, making it sound like such a overly epic song where they should have just chilled the fuck out with it a little bit. But yeah, I was down with this one. This was one to revisit when you do revisit this album again. I think you should check this one out because it might make you like the original a little bit more and all that, and go back and kind of dive into that song because it really is one of them. A beautiful song. Cut Here, I really love the song, so I kind of feel like this was another missed opportunity because they could have done something a little cooler to showcase a different aspect of this song. I always feel like it's a highly underrated later Cure song, but I feel like there's some great like New Order-y riffs that a lot of the last two albums didn't have, and this song had them still. You know, there's like some great hooks on this song, and really love it, but I don't like this remix of it. And they remixed this one for the B-side. This was the new song that was on the Greatest Hits. So yeah, I mean, and they put out a single for it, and it had remixes, so this kind of just sounds like another one of those where it's like not bad, but it just kind of meh. But I love this song. It's a good song. But yeah, moving on to the next two. Lost, I was never big on. The next one was like the first song on the self-titled. One of my more favorite ones on the self-titled, but song just gets annoying halfway through it. He's just yelling, and you know, it's like kind of cool that it's aggressive Robert, but like it's and this remix does nothing for me. I kind of would stick with the rockin' version if I had to choose. I think this is where it starts to show on these last two songs that the songwriting isn't as good in my opinion. So, and that's kind of my problem with the last two albums, is that when it works, it works, but on these two songs aren't necessarily my favorite written songs, you know. And you know, it's cool enough, and I'm glad that he picked something to represent him. It would be worse if he just like cut it at Cut Here and didn't even acknowledge the past two albums. Would make me feel a little sadder, even though they're not my favorites. So I'm glad they're on there, but I don't know, I didn't really feel anything for it. And then the last song, I think, is just a not great Cure song, so this version didn't make me like it anymore, and didn't like it any less. So it's just kind of a rambly song. It's just kind of a mess. It doesn't go anywhere. It's over. And it's the last song on 413 Dream, so it's the last song that they've officially put out. But, you know, it's good that it represents, but it's not a great song. So what I do wish, if we're tweaking stuff and kind of doing final thoughts, lose the Never Enough one. We don't need another version or to address that song anymore. We all know it's out there. So lose that and remix or put out at least a new song that nobody's, even if it isn't great. It would have been cool to have a new song on the end of this, I think. Even those two new ones they played at the live shows, It Can Never Be the Same. That would be perfect fucking time, even if they put out like an overly remixed version of that, you know, and then they could put that out as a single. Bam, problem solved, you know? So I don't know. Maybe he's got a grand master plan, but why the fuck didn't he just tack it on? Because it would have fit in continuity with Mixed Up, and it would have been a little extra something for the fans, and you know. But yeah, I'm sure they had a recording of it. They should have just put it on there, in my humble opinion. But
makes sense.
But otherwise, I'm totally happy with this. I think it is what it is. Like I said, I was Yeah, I was never crazy about Mixed Up either. I think, no, I mean, I put it on and I'll listen to it and enjoy it, but I don't like feel like any of these songs are better than the originals. But that doesn't mean you can't listen to them and enjoy it. You know, it's like, it's on par. I'm happier that they put this out as opposed to like another semi-generic live album or some stupid ass sort of best of, you know, like a fucking half best of.
Like their last best of one, like...
Well, that was a little I don't know how necessary that was, but that was more of a concise best of. So yeah, that was necessary at that point. But if they did another, but if they did another one like that, which a lot of bands at this point in their career do, you know, and you know, I'd be more insulted if they just put out a sort of generic best of with one new song even on it. That would have been worse, you know. So it's right. So you know, I think it's cool. I like I said earlier, I would not prefer to wait 10 years for this to come out, you know, like Mixed Up is great because it came in between, you know, Disintegration and Wish, which are two huge awesome albums. So it's like yeah whatever, fuck it, who cares, it's a Mixed Up. It's that was kind of the cool thing about Mixed Up. It was just something to kind of a breath of something different before they dive into the next era of whatever they're going for. And you know, so this is a little bit of a weird island where it's like, why now? Why this? You know, and like it kind of is like standing there naked for everybody to kind of poke at, you know. But it's a
and to give Mixed Up and hopefully this is it called Turn Down or whatever?
torn down. Yes.
Turned on. Not turned on, but Mixed Up did get me into electronic shit.
Yeah. Okay.
So I have to give The Cure and Mixed Up credit for that, because that shit was like, was a game changer for me. It was just like, who did this? What's this? And then it just snowballed.
Yeah. And our earlier point of writing-wise or, you know, even electronic-wise, if this did the same thing to any kids out there, then it's fucking worth its weight in gold, you know?
Yeah,
and,
totally.
And maybe the essence, I feel like a lot of these songs, even though they don't come anywhere close to a lot of the originals, a lot of them, the essence is there. You know, you hear fucking Never Enough on this, it would be pretty much the same. You'd be like, oh, that's kind of cool if somebody heard this in a friend's car or something, yeah, or wherever the like fuck, you know? Yeah, then, you know, maybe that would be enough. And then you go back and realize how much cooler the real version of A Strange Day is or something. So that's, you know, worth its weight in gold. And that's a good way to do it.
All the songs that are behind A Strange Day, you know?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's all got its place. I think it's just a different perspective, and who knows. It's kind of neat that it is Robert Smith, because if it was just some generic dude remixing it and it sounded like this, I'd be more like, well, right, he just didn't see the vision of the song or something, you know. So like whatever the fuck, Robert,
like out if it was like not good,
yeah,
you know. It's like, oh, it's like,
well, he just doesn't get the cure, you know. Yeah, it's like, well, Robert Smith definitely gets the cure, so whatever the fuck he's choosing to showcase is for a reason of some sort, you know, whether you agree with it or not. Yeah. He decided to take this perspective of seeing this song, and you know. So on that note, I don't know, people out there, we'll be curious to hear your thoughts. Yeah, since this is fresh and new too, so maybe everyone else is feeling drastic one way or the other, so feel free to let us know what you think. We would love to hear more opinions on this, and
or don't.
Yeah, all right, whatever. Let us do our thing. It is what it is. And what do you think, Donald? Anything on top of that, or should we wrap this thing up? Are you going to let me do the recap, or should I add this in later? I'll do the quick version. All right, be sure to subscribe on iTunes. We're there. If you hate iTunes, go to Podcast Guarding. That's where we're coming from direct. Find us on Instagram. That's where all the action's at, apparently. So
Farty666.
That's Donald, if it isn't obvious. And so yeah, the Holy Hour Podcast on Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And the Facebook page is where you get all the bonus stuff, so go on over there and drop us or me a line there.
And I'm not on Facebook, so I see nothing of.
Yeah, I'll relay it to Donald. So
you guys,
really,
you guys
wanna
have to hit me up on Insta.
Yeah, well, we'll make sure it gets to him. So hit him there or me directly, and I'll relay it to Donald, gavinconner so at gmail.com. And on top of that, you know, we'll check out our usual friends, but Donald's going to chit-chat over this, so yep. I better just let them all be for now. And we'll see you soon. We got many great episodes on the horizon. And go tear it up or mix it up, one or the other. Over and out. Talk hard.
Talk hard.